regard, or in relation to FUP, the development of the new subway lines in Stockholm, some issues had come up, and one of the artists there, well, Axel Lieber, you might know, he can't be with us today, but he passes his regards to you, and I know that you met last week, mentioned, actually, there is a similar project that just been concluded in Düsseldorf, a project that spanned over 10 to 15 years, almost?
15 years.
15 years.
Beginning on, yes.
Mm. And maybe you should speak to one of the key persons there. And as a lawyer, I was thinking initially, that's really, really good, that I can speak to Heike about all the problems, and then we can like, talk problems, and then that way we can avoid the problems. And it was really nice, the first discussions we had. I came out of there thinking, actually, you know, things can go well. You know, they can actually succeed. That was one of the main surprises I had. Like, she's actually happy, it worked out. No one, normally when I come into projects, it's because everybody is super angry with each other, you know? So, kind of shell damaged by that. Our first book changed my attitude a little bit. And I was thinking that maybe we shouldn't focus on trying to avoid all the problems. Maybe we should rather focus on trying to learn from situations where problems have arisen, because they will arise, and where people have been able to deal with those problems in a constructive way. And as a first step in that change of attitude, and not just focusing on problems, but in, you know, trying to avoid problems, but trying to talk about them, it's was inviting Heike. So I leave the floor to you now. Welcome. Very exciting to have you here.
Thank you very much. Thank you for your wonderful introduction and for having me, and to all of you to being here and sharing, having a discussion and being interested in the Wehrhahn in Düsseldorf. Mm-hmm. So I'm here, like Sophie said, we planned the Wehrhahn for like 15 years. Netzwerk Architekten and me won the initial competition, and then designed the overall concept for the line. And it's today when I look, well, I don't want to look back, I want to look forward, but I'm very pleased to be here to share some insights, especially on the project in the context of art, architecture, engineering, and politics also, because like how things to work together in this project are maybe kind of special, and maybe we can take out something out of this experience. And how we started was that Netzwerk Architekten, for the initial competition, Netzwerk Architekten and me developed a holistic concept for the whole subway tunnel as an underground spatial continuum, and that flies under the city like a giant snake to the earth and widening at the stations. And the entrances to the six stations are unique designed as cuts, and that's also where the art takes place. So get deeper into the single stations and show you the details, like to give you an insight into the concept or thoughts we had in the beginning and how things develop, and also a little bit backstage information, like looking behind the scenes.
I can see that we are not just arriving, that there is a book about the project as well.
Yeah.
I will open.
So if anybody wants to look, have a look at it, it's also available in the book.
Yeah,
it can also be
so that way, if you want some inside information, you don't need to note everything down. There is actually published here. I leave it here for when we have coffee, and you can have a peek.
So, coming back to today, the Wehrhahn line was opened in February 2016. That's a little bit more, that's 1.5 years ago. new stations between Zurich and Wehrhahn. And let me start in the beginning. When you start thinking about constructing a new subway line, the crucial point is, or for us was, on one hand, maintaining the overall identity for the line, and while allowing a diversity for the individual stations. And addressing precisely this ambiguity, we came up with the concept continuum and cut. So horizontally, the continuum comprises the entire tunnel, including the stations along the line, what you see here in gray. And by contrast, the cuts connect the respective stations with the urban fabric on the street. So that's the vertical connection. And each maintaining their own identity when acting within this vertical defined space. So, during the concept, we worked with an image of a giant snake as it slips through the earth and widening at the stations between continuing its path. So, so this worked out into the geometry of each station, and they have a great variety in geometry because they depend on the layout on the cityscape, and then how within this specific urban situation they connect to the underground. So here, this is the different cuts into the stations, which you've seen before with the coloured image. So now I would like to take you on a trip through the six stations and entering the station Station Kirchplatz. The Kirchplatz can be accessed downhill from the northwest. The three entrances connect to the urban fabric. And the south access is characterized by an inclined funnel-shaped void. It cuts down the ceiling of the space up to track level, so that the tracks are visible from the stairs to the concourse. You will find these cuts, which are very small on the city's level, and then open up to the space at both at different, at some more stations. And it's interesting, maybe I can mention the first collaboration, which was between architects and engineers at a very early stage, because usually what makes constructing a subway expensive is digging on the earth. You know, so usually you would like to have a very small space under underground to not to spend so much money. But when architects and engineers, they came together and talked about different possibilities, and so they found very good possibilities to open up the space underground, have sidelines without spending more money with an equal sum of money that otherwise would only have a small space. So still we are at Kirchplatz, and here a view from the track level into the station. As I said, the sidelines and the light that enters through the funnel provide a clear linkage of the track zone in the world above the surface. And for the station at Kirchplatz, the artist Anne Hendel wrote poetic texts and then gave them a sculptural life. So the lines of the text begin at the entrances and follow the people down in the station. And since they have the three-dimensional quality, so they can also only be read in a from certain perspectives, like whispering, you listen, you're going down to a subway and you listen only to parts of the other people going down. That's a perspective a look. You're of course on track level, and it's a view from the continuum within the staircase towards the green cut. Mm. And this perspective shows very clearly how the cut into the continuum functions, and how it's defining the character of each station, and how both principles also, the continuum and the cut, are edited. We were talking about it like a hard cut in the film. And this is the view from the opposite direction, from the green cut towards the continuum. And again, you see the hard cut, where the two principles meet and come together. And on the left side, you see the luminous green glass with a flow of lines that again accompanies the passenger from the street level down to the platform level. That's a work by Manuel Franke, the artist. Oops, didn't want to go there. It's a work by the artist Manuel Franke, and I would like to talk a little bit about how this painting in the space, or this immersive space, was being created, because maybe it could be interesting also for you, since you're, I think, some or all of you are also about to work in a metro line, or in the planning of a subway here in Stockholm. Here, on a different way, a manual process, an artistic process, was implemented into an industrial production process. You see here, the glass panels were processed by hand, directly by the artist, and during the production process in the glass foundry. And one, some technical information. So these technical information in this sense, like how it's done, the glass panels rely on ceramic ink applied by silk screen. And normally they are produced by an additive process. So you would apply the paint on the glass, and then it's put in the oven and heated over 600 degrees. So here we're using a spatula and compressed air. The opposite process, removing color, is implemented into the production process. And this is one example of several within the Bärenline, where we tried to change an existing industrial process. And also, maybe now looking back, or here standing and telling the story, this sounds very simple, but this is really complicated. And since you're from the field, you will know. And but it's really facing enormous challenges if you're not following the standard production process and regularity within like a big construction process or construction project like this. So one question, maybe also open for discussion afterwards, is like, how can one like implement these spaces of modifying situation and processes within a project like this? And questions will come up like, how can this individual glass piece be replaced when it's broken? Or what happens if the artist is ill during the production, becomes ill during the production process? And an interesting question also, it was a hot discussion under the artist, can an artistic project be put into to public tender, to public bidding? And here we had the case that Manuel worked with one glass company, and you saw before here is another view into the production hall, production process, and set up with this company the process. So of course in the beginning we thought, no, it's not possible, you know, it's all set up, we need to go with this company. But this goes against like public bidding for such a big station. And then we decided, okay, let's go for the bidding and let's see what happens. Maybe the company is getting the bid. Of course the company didn't. And then he set up the production process with the other company and it worked. Mm-hmm. So it was good. Maybe it's a good example where also in the whole project for all the years, like everybody jumped over their own shadow. And in this case, Manuel jumped over his own shadow because he said he went into the situation, agreed for bidding. It didn't go the way we thought it would go, but still then it worked out in the end. Heinrich Heinrich is also a very special station in another sense, because here the existing subway line is crossing the existing subway network of Düsseldorf. And at the west end, as you see here, the line connects with two already existing but separate tunnels, which were constructed already 35 years ago, because one thought that maybe one would widen the subway network. So this is one part. So it was a very, in terms of spatial situation, a very diverse situation with three different entrances on levels which were not really connected in a geometric shape. And the other specialty is that the a line runs beneath the central shopping district at the inner city of Düsseldorf, and they are under the heritage of an Art Nouveau department store. So this was, in terms of construction, engineering, a big challenge. And I like to take the chance to have a just brief look at like how the whole line was constructed. This is a tunnel, the tunnel, you know, please I have to look up in English, the tunnel boring machine. Don't use it every day, buddy.
The drill.
The drill. No, it's not a drill. Because it's, you know, it's digging, so it's
a grinder.
It's a grinder, yeah. And so it's a shield tunneling method, and the whole line was mainly constructed in this way because the line means the tunnel was constructed in this way, and at the stations it was a cut and cover method. Why did one choose this method? Because one thought this would be, you know, it's going under the city of the inner city, the line would go under the inner city, and one was hoping that this would give a minimum disturbance to people around. I think there are very different perspectives on this point also. And so the shield tunneling method and cut and cover method, and just because I also really like these images, a few photographs from the construction period. And this is, you know, you see this high-tech method, and then on the other hand, when it comes to connecting the tunnel to the existing network, the very hands-on again method was used like in how do you say when you're digging for a coal, or like in coal, like a mining method. You know, you have like only this, So high tech versus hands on, also in engineering. And the exception that I just mentioned was the heritage Art Deco Kaufhof, and there it was since the tunnel was located directly under this heritage building, it was needed that three diverse entrances, and here Ralf Bröck designed three new entrances connecting the existing line to the other line, and he decided to work with sound. The three rooms are the auditorium, the theater, and the laboratory, and he designed them visually and acoustically for performances of changing sound compositions. So now there's three public spaces able to have, where you can have concerts, or where you can have compositions from people from here or abroad to perform in these spaces. So this is a view into the theater. Each of the spaces, of course, has a high quality sound system, and each room is modeled very differently regarding the acoustic qualities, also regarding like how people would move within the space and how the sound quality is embedded. This is the second space. There for the opening, the musician Kurt Dahlke and Jan Stoja did their composition. And this, since the other two spaces are more like rooms where you move through, here the sound in the laboratory would come from these two sound objects. And for the opening, the composer Stefan Schneider did the composition. Here it's more experimental, and this is the most experimental space compared to the others. I will get to this later, but keep also in mind that here we have a high technology, like all the sound equipment, and we also have this equipment for films later. And it's interesting how, maybe that's also a point for the discussion later, how in a 15 years planning process, how to implement a technology that we now know will be old within 15 or 10 years. So at the station Bentmannerstraße, here you can see the geometry of the station and the cut into the subway station lies perpendicular to the station, and it's again created by an inclined wall. What you see here is the geometry of the station, but flying in the outer space. And imagine the earth surrounding the subway station is taken away and replaced by the cosmos. So this conceptual exposure by the artist Thomas Stricker to turn around above and below was consistently then implemented into the architecture. Here a view into the conference level. The interior of the spaceship was developed probably for the stage, And another view. A matrix like stainless steel embossed matrix covers the wall, and it's irregular, and of course the steel surface conducts light downwards and reflects the colors of the people moving, passing by. Conceived with maps, images and textures from ESA and NASA. So if you follow the planets, you virtually are moved by them. So you stand in the station and you think that you're moving. Maybe looking back, one can say that here architecture and engineering provides an interface between also fact and fiction, and space and narrative, and also physical and virtual space. on one hand, of course, finding and implementing the right technique, but on the other hand, also in terms of time and decision making within the timeline of the project. So the station needed to be enhanced for the technique that was not defined yet 10 years ago. So state of the art for this kind of moving was back then back projection. So we realize that now with LED technology, flat screens. And but that's the technical artistic point of view. So we were lucky because we had a lot of space and then we got flat, but the other way around would have been not so easy. But also thinking of the authorities for the city, this meant to define a budget like 15 years ago for this technique and to keep it and to hold it in the books even though it's not defined. That's usually a process which public bodies would do. And yes, and on the other hand, I already mentioned a big point also here on bidding and public tender, because this was out of the because this was not in the timeline of the whole station. Okay, that's a view into the studio where all the pieces were rendered, of course, with the company who was then able to do it in a cooperation with the artist, but also thinking about it, like having this, like having trusting each other or having free space. So like 10, 15 years ago, the ESA, NASA pictures or images were not available. So Thomas Stricker's concept was there. And of course you can think of a concept being realized in very different ways. So it developed over the time. And so there was also this moment of trust that had to be developed between the stakeholders, so that you know, in the end, you know, it could be the concept of the contemporary concept, and we didn't need to implement a concept from 15 years ago. It could change over time. So the station Schadowstrasse. Here, passengers approach the west of the stations on a station on Jan Wellenplatz via a short right entrance point connected to the upper concourse. And a large skyline, you see here in the vertical, is integrated. A large skyline is integrated into the ground level. And this is important also for the work that Ursula Damm realized. She has created an interactive installation connecting the surface of the city with the underground, and the real-time movements of the people on the city surface, the real-time movements, they are tracked and then put into a specially developed software, and that the movement so the tracking of the people on city level is not visualized, but it's used as energy, which then is used to create virtual architecture, which there you see on the screen. So this is artistic, digital, enhanced process, and it's creating a moving image. So here, behind the projection, here a totally a room for the technique was planned in this shell construction, and this, of course, was at a very early stage. So here you see both of them standing behind the projection. And colors, but more as a concept. So it was not that the stations were defined by colors. But then during the working process, we found out, or during our presentations, that kind of every station had a color or bent into the sliding direction of a color. So we came back and thought, why not like taking the conceptual color and like putting it in real colors? So it was easy at some stations, for example, Manuel Franco, it was green. But that here maybe it could have been slightly another color, or then we come back to or the station we'll see later. It's a black and white station, so we had the discussion, can a black and white station cut into the black and white continuum? All these discussions we had, and then we came up, you see the stations with the colors, and decide yourself if you find them colorful or if the color is more conceptual or real. again, the opposing view, direction from the staircase towards the platform level, and I think you can also see how the continuum has is performing the hard cut to the staircases or to the artistic work. And the Tempelvaterstraße subway station has 5 access points, and the distribution level are connected by a central cut that bites into the continuum in a seesaw shape, you see here. So that's a very early model, and that's the station that I was working on. And since I was, well, I was working with a specific geometry of the space, maybe, well, I did it, and I did it maybe because I had so much thought about the geometry of the spaces within the whole concept as well. So I took the directions of the movements from each entrance and extended them into the station. So the called the bands would start at the 5 entrance points. And then run into the station, run across the wall, floor, ceiling, following the geometry of the room down to the platform level. You can think of it like a billiard ball splitting apart when it hits a corner. So all bands led into the stations, and the end point of the design is the moment when all the bands have left the station again. So by this moment they have been reflected as many as several hundred times. And here is a paper model of the full station. And here is one single band structure. And this is a view into the compost level at Tempelvaterstraße West. The band structure is white and the interstices are black. And the whole station is conceptually arranged also on separate layers, like the architectural space, and then the narrative space, and then the guideline system, and then the passengers in movement. And so that's also why the okay, I'm getting to this later, but I can say it here. So this is also why we had to work on the guidance system in a very specific color. And there we had like red, yellow, green, pink. And it was a discussion that went over, I don't know, maybe 2 or 3 years with the people, like the blind, how do you say, the
Blind Association?
Yes, the association, thank you, the Blind Association. And we did, well, of course you have to meet the, this is interesting because of course you have to meet the regularities, so there has to be a specific then it's never only about regularities. It's also then people start discussing this view, they have their own ideas, and even if it's within the framework of the regularities, it's specific. So this was a very long discussion, and finally we decided for the yellow concrete, and then which then we also developed because this bright color was not available on the market. Okay, and other view into the station with the guideline system for the blind, and we see like how the floor, walls, and ceiling come together, and view how within the line several developments of new materials were achieved. This was one of them, to a very vibrant colored concrete. And I was saying before, or mentioning in the beginning, for the detailed design and execution planning, we did not only models and drawings, but we did one-to-one mock-ups. And this was very, very important. It was maybe halfway of the designing and planning process in one of the tunnels that were not used in the subway network. And it's so important, like talking about something physical, because then everybody can agree upon it. It's so different than only having words in a room. And this is one thing which works for drawings, models, and also the one-to-one mock-ups. But in another perspective, it was also very important for setting a benchmark for the firms bidding for the work. And so this was set, and no way around it. And we did this for each station. I like this image because this is a non-used subway tunnel, but then all the mock-ups from all the stations.
Can we visit this?
It's not there anymore.
It's not there anymore.
Yeah, it would be nice to have it as an exhibition. So I think it's not there anymore. It's very difficult to get the key. Coming to the continuum, but here the mock-up of course for the continuum, and in terms of colors, in contrast to the colors of the entrance spaces, the continuum features a bright relief-like network structure, and the small graphic unit is the smallest graphic unit is a diamond, and it is completely and constantly varied by the joints between the structural elements, resulting in this spatial drawing. The structure systematically expands and contracts, and so is creating this kind of dynamic space. And here a detail. So also for the production of the concrete diamonds for the continuum, it would not have been possible without research into material development and production processes. We did it in close collaboration with a small company in south of Germany, Schwabstein, and have developed a production process that makes it possible to produce panels with an extreme geometry and that as well do not require additional structural bracing. And of course we needed a very high degree of precision and surface quality. So all 6,700 diamonds for the continuum were produced then with the vacuum filter press method. This is the only you see there in orange. And probably you're familiar with the usual casting process in concrete. So we have a mold and put the concrete in, also placing it into another context. And of course, one has to be and make the experience that I or we needed to be prepared to leave our comfort zone. And it's easy to say, but sometimes more than you know I thought I was, would be able to. And but if we also made the good experience that all people that were on board were willing to take this path, that is not always so easy. And I think one thing is very important to build a situation of trust that always there were conflicts, of course, and but even if through these conflicts one had we felt that everybody was pulling together, even if one would not understand or accept the other side. So, and so trust grew with time, and maybe sometimes also a moderation from outside can be helpful. And but what I found especially incredible is that the quality in all different fields got better and better. So the art gained through its unique presence, which I think it's also appeal through the strict framework of the transportation building. Sometimes the strict framework can also help to be very precise. And at the same time, the interdisciplinary cooperation enabled the art, also enabled processes that in engineering, for example, to take another path, which maybe would not be been have possible without the arguments from the art. So we try to, in this sense, the art was able to take the engineering also to the limits of the feasibility in terms of space and the materials and the technology used. So now it's true, everybody is very happy, not only me, but the artists, the authorities, the architects, I hope also the people from Düsseldorf, and sometimes I'm surprised myself when looking back in this process and thinking, surprised what we could achieve in this heterogeneous group, even though if one now is looking at it, maybe looks like you know it was planned like this from the beginning. And let me end with a very short Sheila.
Cheeky to take the first question and then leave the floor open.
Questions first, okay, questions. So one question which is maybe not so hard, it's maybe a question that we've all had, it's just that looking back now, I was going to say, would you have done anything differently? And then I realized that's too much of a vague question, so rather, if you could have done one thing differently, what would that be, if anything?
I was always thinking, what would I do again like this, and not what would I think differently, so actually, I have to take the question on my way because you can ask again if I'm not getting to the point. But so before coming here, I was also asking my architectural colleagues and people from the city to like, what do you think? You know, like, is the point? Of course, and then I realized everybody had a very different perspective on it, like from things that one cannot change, like that when we all started, we were all youngsters. You know, we were all 35 years old, and we won the competition for like the big against big companies. We didn't think of it, and then we grew old with the project. And no, but in a way, it's good because it was not only the art. We were all the same group, like artists, architects, city authorities, and from the authorities. Now they retired, you know, so, but it's good to have a person, and that's what I also want to make, like, trying to have a continuity in the project is very important, and that's probably not for the artist, because you're a continuity in yourself, that's probably more thinking about it from the point of view of the city, you know, how can one get a continuity in the project. I don't know what I would have made different.
You can't have to take the tube in Düsseldorf now. Because that's another question I think that's relevant for all of us. We have elections next year. How did you deal? You must have had elections in 15 years. And were there any problems with that, or did that just run smoothly?
Actually, yes. Were, but thank God, at kind of the very end. So things couldn't really. Well, in the very beginning, there we really had, in the beginning, now you have all these geometric shapes. So in the beginning, the tube was also a rounded shape. And we went during the first 2 or 3 years through major redesign of the station, which helped there was for us to keep the red flat, that we had the concept of the continuum and the cuts. So we could also merge it on the different geometries. But there we had save so much money. And so things went very different. Then we had continuity. And in the end of the project, the politics changed. But then we were at a point where, you know, it was all.
And it's too late.
It was too late. Actually, too many things against it.
So work fast and make sure politicians come.
That can be a problem, yes.
I have much more questions, but I do feel that this forum was for you too. So I need to, do you have any questions? Or shall I just our chair.
You say you won the competition, so you won the competition for all the stations.
Yes.
Were you a team with several
yes.
artists?
The most important thing I didn't mention. So thank you for the question, because a very special thing that distinguishes this project from many other art competitions is that the city of Düsseldorf at that time, it competes very like in, for the arts, decided that we wanted to do a competition where artists, engineers, and architects work together from the first point, and this really made the difference. Mm-hmm. So. And this competition was won by Netzwerk Architekten and me. And so we designed the overall concept for the line. And we were also thinking how can art be implemented into the line. So we decided to have like the spaces between the city, where the vertical spaces would be the spaces for the art. And then we had a second competition where we invited artists for the specific, only for concept. Only for concept, for the
I'm not sure if I followed, so there were spaces, specific spaces that the artists could work with. It wasn't just that you might work with this space. They had, you had some kind of model to...
Yes, it's typically you would have a real space, but here we more had the concept, you know, which would result in a very specific space, and during the competition, we thought, and we gave, of course, the concept and the spaces to the artists, so they could decide for a specific space. But then during the early, 3 years or so, this was switched, but then every artist stayed at their station till the end. Mm-hmm. But at the very early concept phase, there was also change in the process.
And just short, who did you choose the artists?
We wanted not to be the ones to choose, so we set up a competition with the museum people and independent jury. It was also important that we wanted to give the framework. Of course, I designed the continuum and one with the station, and for the others, we wanted it to be very diverse.
That was another question I had to you that's kind of personal as well, because I think it's interesting how you were part of the main concept, but you were also one of the artists. Mm-hmm. So you had kind of two hats in the process.
Yes.
Was that good to have someone, because my experience is you guys don't call me when things go well, and you only call me when things don't go well, so I do have a negative starting point, but my experience is that sometimes there is different languages between mm-hmm. the people doing the program or a concept and the people actually hands-on. But there you were kind of a link between those two worlds. Was that an advantage or was it difficult at some times?
Well, I think in our case, but also I think it was an advantage, but it's also that I like moderation processes and I like trying to make things possible where, it seems not to be possible. So I had a sparring partner with the architects, and we were very good together. And so, and also from the city, who communicated very well then into politics. And so, I think it was very good because in the overall function, I could also have a function of translating. Translating artistic processes and also maybe giving trust, saying, okay, it's a very, very strong concept. We're not sure at this point how it's going to precisely working out down to each screw, and how can we set the framework? So talking on a little bit more abstract way and not being involved in the project, sometimes it's easier. Sometimes it was easier for me to talk for other projects than to do it for my own.
Yeah, because that kind of leads to the other question.
Yes.
I'd like to have some advice from you. How do you gain the trust from public authorities? Now, I don't know if
you have the
trust. You have the trust.
Maybe you have the trust already.
Maybe I have the trust. Because that's, I don't know if you agree with me, but sometimes I feel like a key component in a successful story is if you have someone at the public authority, if you have someone that speaks your language.
It's interesting, and I was also thinking about it. Maybe I don't have a final answer, but trust is not something that arises from somewhere. But it's one can also think about frameworks, which make trust possible, And this is also about regularities, about finances, about dates, timelines, about communication within the group and outside, who is informed, with whom does one, who is taking the decisions, with whom, and who is informed, and who has also the power to take it. Interesting also in when one thinks in terms of authorities.
Mm-hmm. Can you think of any?
I go with examples, and there were probably many, many more. We did it, learning by doing. Yeah, talking now, looking back. But I think one point which is, I would say, was important, that we did had an intense communication process, especially in the first half of the project. Intense, sometimes too much, but in all different directions. So, for example, at a very, very early stage, we invited the people from the city, and not only the decision maker, but also the people working in the project, to the studios of the artists. And it was a moderated process, so not only just go there and look, but we prepared the whole thing, we prepared the whole setting, and went to the studios to, first to talk to each other and to develop a deeper understanding also for the art. And then we continued this, and maybe 2 years later or so, and there was the next step. But we also had, this was, it was a clear structure, it was moderated, we wanted it, it was not paid or something, we did it because we needed it for the project. And then, in terms of decision making, we had before at points where we had different steps in the project where decisions for the artwork and the architecture were made, and we said we're not going back beyond all. We have to agree on this now, and from there we go further. And there we had a public presentations, where we also, not public, but public presentations where all artists were there. They were also, because in a big project, then you don't know what is happening in the other station. And at a certain point, we realized that there is a lack of information between, the artists. So we did this. And then it was an extensive communication also, but depends on the time, but into politics.
I saw that you had a question here.
You said that the architecture and the engineers and the artists were all about working together from the beginning, yes? That at every station there was different artists, yes? Mm-hmm. Was it the same with the architecture and the engineers? Were they also new ones at every station? Or was it just the artists?
So the continuity was Netzwerk Architekten and me and the engineers. And after the second competition, we invited them 5 more artists. So only the artists were different at the station, but it was the same architects.
You mentioned financing.
Yes,
financing, the big money, the big question. So how was the financing set up in your project? In terms, how were the artists remunerated,
rather? We were discussing about it, and from Axel I know a little bit, the setting, but it's, I just talk about how it was set up. Looking back, we also, we did it, we had a sum, which was, I can say it in this, not filming me, it was 15 years back, it was 80,000 euro per artist, and it was set the first 20,000, the first 25% were the artist fee in the beginning. The second 25% were paid upon finishing the detailed planning. The third 25% were paid at, I think, the end of the bidding phase, something like this, and then the last after everything was finished. Mm-hmm. And also looking back, it was, from my point of view, a good system, because the one thing is one was always paid when one didn't work, and when one worked a lot, when one didn't have the money. So this is a little bit asynchronous,